Submission. Wives, put yourself under the mission of your husband. What's the mission of the husband? It's right in the next line. Husbands, treat your wives like doormats. Oh, I'm sorry. What does your translation say? Love your wives. How? As Christ loved the church. How did Christ love the church?
He gave up his life.
Unto death. Christ said, I came into the world not to be served, but to serve and to lay down my life for my bride. Do we know what Paul is saying when we read this in context? Wives, submit to your husbands. You know what he's saying? He's saying, wives, allow your husbands to serve you. As Christ served the church unto death. To which I respond, who's got it worse here? Ladies, correct me if I am wrong, but imagine if you were married to a man who took St. Paul very seriously, that his mission in life is to love you this way. Imagine if you were married to a man who would prefer to die a gruesome death than ever, ever violate your dignity and goodness. In fact, why did he die? To make the bride beautiful, spotless, without wrinkle, stain, blemish, or any such thing. Imagine if you had a man who was willing to die for your beauty. Correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't that exactly what you're looking for in a husband? The deepest level of the feminine heart? Isn't this what all those knight in shining armor romantic fantasies are? The scripture is not against us. The scripture is for us. But there is an enemy who is against us, whose goal is to twist scripture so we don't understand what it's saying to us. Because if we understand what this is saying to us, this is our salvation and liberation. 1a, we can conclude that the wife's submission to the husband means above all the experiencing of love. This is all the more so because the submission of the church to Christ certainly consists in experiencing his love. The church is imposing nothing here. The church is just revealing what's already present in a woman's heart, what she really desires. Don't believe me? Why did young women and older women all around the world flock to see the movie Titanic? How many have seen it more than once, ladies? Be honest. More than twice? Three times? Four times? Five times? See, you looking guilty. How many times? Do I hear seven? Do I hear eight? Seven. Can anybody top seven? Over here. How many we got? Eight? Three. No, we're working for high. Where was that third? No, three. All right. Well, ladies, don't feel too bad. I have seen Braveheart 19 times. Yeah, we'll get to Braveheart in a minute, but now I want to talk about Titanic. Look at the message of this movie. What's the story? Jeff Havens, friend of mine, he says, what are we to assume? That all of a sudden, women all around the world had a strange fascination with large boats? Look at the story. Jack, despite his flaws, loved Rose very genuinely, saving her from that domineering beep of a fiance, allowing her true personality to blossom. Remember the dancing scene under the deck? She's coming out of her shell, finally. She's coming out of that hole. What's that thing called?
Mm-hmm.
Corset. And all of that is symbolic, that tightening up of the corset thing. You will marry this man. Oh, sick. Jack saves her from that whole sick situation of male domination and controlling the mother and all that stuff. She's blossoming. And what does he do at the end of the movie?
He lays down his life for her.
Jack.
Oh, none of you have seen that movie, huh? 5, folks. No, not the scene in the car. Get that out of there. But you know what? I was not offended by that sketching scene. There's something tender there. There's something sweet there. And there's a little glimmer of nakedness without shame there. I'm not saying it's perfect, but you get a little glimmer of it. Guys, why do we love Braveheart? Here's a guy who is ready, and can anybody talk 19 times, by the way? Here's a guy who is ready and willing to lay down everything unto the most gruesome, bloody death. Why? Most people say for freedom. That's part of the theme. But do you remember what his big red-headed friend Hamish says to him? William, you're not doing it for freedom. You're doing it for Martin. Morin was his wife. You're doing it for Martin because you think she sees you. She had died. The British killed her to get to William. And William's living this whole thing out to defend her good honor. He says, I don't think she sees me. I know she does. And your father sees you too. And William goes unto the most brutal, torturous death to uphold her dignity, her honor. Who's the last person he sees before they chop off his head? Her, walking through the crowd, welcoming him into eternal life. Don't we want to be William Wallace, guys? Don't we want to fight that fight and hold up that bloody sword at the end? That's my favorite scene. Oh, it's awesome. Every time. We want to be William, but here's the problem. Most of us, we're more like Robert the Bruce, aren't we? We want to be William, but we falter, we betray. Remember that scene with Robert the Bruce and his decrepit, leprous father? After his decrepit, leprous father had convinced him to betray William? And he says to his father, he says, William fights for something that I've never had. And I took it from him. I stole it from him. I saw it on his face on the battlefield, and it's tearing me apart. And his leprous father says, all men betray. All men lose heart. And Robert says, I don't want to lose heart. I want to believe. As he does. I will never be on the wrong side again. And one of the most beautiful parts of this movie is that even though Robert betrayed William, William believes in Robert. There is strength in you, I see it. Unite us. Unite us. Brothers, believe me, I know what it means to be a weak man. Believe me, I know what it means to use a woman, treat her as an object. We are called to so much more, and we know it. Don't we know it? We know we're called to more. Brothers, I believe in you. There is strength in you. I see it. Unite us. Unite the clans. Unite us. Unite us. There's a reason men love this movie. It calls us out. Let it call you out. And let the Pope call you out right here, gentlemen. 1C. Now don't read ahead. The joy comes in experiencing this moment together. Some of you have read ahead. If a husband is truly to love his wife, it is necessary to insist that intercourse must not serve merely as a means of allowing his climax, the Pope says. The man must take the difference between male and female reactions into account so that climax may be reached by both and, as far as possible, occur in both simultaneously. Yes, the Pope wrote this. The husband must do this not for hedonistic reasons, but for altruistic reasons, self-giving reasons. In this case, if we take into account the shorter and more violent curve of arousal in the man, such tenderness on his part in the context of marital intercourse acquires the significance of an act of virtue. I do not want to see a show of hands, that would be far too much information. I do want to call every husband and every future husband in this room, in this church, to this time of virtue. We all know the stereotypical image of the selfish male who has his pleasure and rolls over and falls asleep. Such a man cannot be said to love his wife as Christ loves the church. Christ came so that his joy might be in us and our joy might be full or complete. And yes, the marital union itself is meant to be an image of this joy, of the eternal joy in the Trinity, given to us through the sacrament of marriage, which means given to us through Jesus Christ. That's how glorious and astounding is the marital union.